Police investigate over 18,000 homicides a year. But only in the toughest of these cases are a select group of investigators brought in. Trained to probe criminal behavior, they journey into the psyche of the criminal, searching for clues. There's no one qualification for the job, other than an overwhelming fascination with the criminal mind. These are the criminal profilers. Stumble on a horrific sight. A young girl lay dead in a roadside ditch, her body fatally stabbed 35 times. The victim was 17-year-old Crystal Todd. She had to be identified by her high school ring.
We have a homicide, female victim, laying in a creek area.
Captain David Caldwell, a profiler with the South Carolina Law Enforcement Division, was called to the scene.
Why would anyone do this to this girl? She was a very pleasant, very sociable, well-liked person who should not have been the victim of such a crime.
Crystal Todd was a senior at Conway High School. She played piano at her church and had dreams of going to college. The tiny community was stunned by the brutal murder of one of its children and demanded answers from the local police.
To be quite honest with you, we were looking for help. And I'm not trying to say that we were in over our heads, even though we may have been. But it was something that we had not been exposed to, a crime of this magnitude.
When you get ready to move her, we'll look for lividity.
When I go on to the scene, I try to imagine what the victim first heard, what they first saw. When did they know that they were in trouble?
And her bra is also torn. She's not wearing any shoes or wearing socks.
As soon as you can get some Polaroids back out here, we can go ahead and take a look at those.
Police officers traditionally look for clues. That's what we've done for centuries. Okay. That's like fingerprints and physical evidence. David, on the other hand, looks into the mind of the individual, and he goes from past behaviors of people that have committed such acts. We saw the body of a 17-year-old girl in a ditch. We see that she's fully exposed to the elements and she's not hidden in any way. David pointed out to us that was a sign of disorganization, that a killer could have taken two more minutes and hidden the body in a manner that may have never been found.
So it was my estimation early on that whoever killed Crystal Todd did not think he would become a suspect.
If he really thought that he would become a suspect, you might expect him to take a little more time to try to conceal her body.
An autopsy confirmed that Crystal had been raped and stabbed repeatedly, her body mutilated after death. A sample of the suspect's semen was recovered from the young girl's body. Beginning with the school parking lot where her car was found, David Caldwell retraced Crystal's last hour.
I did not think that this would have been a stranger blowing through town, mostly because it appeared that she had put the car there, moved her car there, met someone, and left. Whoever she met there, she had to feel comfortable talking to them, leaving with them. I mean, there was nothing that she feared when she left there. Certainly it's not impossible that someone could have come along, seen her waiting in that parking lot for a friend, and they'd jump out of their car or truck and grab her and whisk her away. That's certainly a possibility, but we just have to try to determine what's probable. Because that's what I think profilers do, is they try to look at what probably happened.
Based on similar cases, Caldwell knew that these types of killers tended to be in their late 20s or early 30s.
I'd like to hook up with Major.
In this particular case, I brought the age of the perpetrator down a little bit from late 20s because I did feel like this person was an acquaintance. And also there was some recklessness there that did not speak of the maturity and the sophistication that I would normally attribute to someone 30 years of age. I was thinking that whoever killed this girl very likely would have committed date rapes earlier. I mean, you don't just suddenly wake up one day, kidnap, rape, and murder someone. That's not exactly your maiden voyage into the world of criminality.
Only 7 days after David Caldwell arrived in Conway, he delivered his profile. He felt that Crystal Todd's murderer would be a white male in his early 20s. He would be a friend of Crystal's, living within a 5-mile radius. He would have had trouble with teachers, friends, and especially law enforcement. Because of the blunt force trauma to Crystal's skull, Caldwell felt that the killer would be strong, possibly working in construction. And based on Caldwell's past experience, he felt that once in custody, it would take 4 to 6 hours to elicit a confession.
The first reaction to the profile was somewhat amazement, because here we'd been looking all around and not within.
By narrowing the focus of the investigation, Caldwell would then propose a unique approach to locating a suspect.
Some of the best physical evidence that we had in this case was the semen that was recovered during the autopsy. And so I recommended to the task force that we start identifying males in Crystal's circle of acquaintances that fit the description that I'd proffered.
I said, you're looking for a hometown boy, I believe. Let's certainly look there first.
Over the next 3 months, using Crystal's address books, detectives tracked down many of her friends and acquaintances. They took 51 blood samples. The first 50 came back negative.
We received a call from the DNA examiner, and the question was, who is Johnny Kenneth Register? We've got a match on the DNA.
Mr. Register was, in fact, close with the family. He had dated Crystal several times prior to this act and had somewhat of a social acquaintance with her throughout her life. The day his blood was drawn, that particular evening, he went back to the dead girl's mother. He, being Register, went back to the dead girl's mother and told her that the police were getting ready to make a mistake, that they were getting ready to arrest the wrong individual. As a matter of fact, the night that Crystal Faye Todd was reported missing, that was the first person that Bonnie Faye Todd called to check to see if he knew whereabouts of Crystal. To say that Mr. Register was close, I'll use Bonnie Faye's words, and her words were, of all the people that the police asked me about who was the closest to Crystal, Ken Register was the name I'd always give him.
The task force looked more closely at Register's association with Crystal, and we were all amazed to find that he was a pallbearer in her funeral. That's something you don't see every day. I remember thinking, I can't wait to ask him about this. I want to hear what that was like carrying his murder victim to the grave.
On February 23, 1992, John Register was brought in for questioning. He told police that he had met Crystal at the middle school parking lot at approximately 11:15 p.m. Register claimed that they drove out to a lover's lane and had sex. He said that when Crystal discovered that he had not used a condom, she became furious. According to Register, she threatened that if she became pregnant, she would cry rape. True to David Caldwell's profile, 5 hours and 10 minutes later, John Register confessed to the murder.
According to Mr. Register, he removed a knife from the glove box area between the two seats of his automobile and started stabbing Crystal as she stepped outside the car to get dressed. He says that he remembers stabbing her once or twice, and that he doesn't remember anything after that until he drags her body to the ditch and throws her into it.
The accuracy of Caldwell's profile was stunning. He had predicted a white male in his early 20s. John Register was white, male, and 19 years old. He lived only 3 miles from Crystal Todd, did indeed work in construction, and was a close friend of the Todd family.
I had predicted the psychosexual maladjustment, and we found out, of course, that he had made threatening phone calls, obscene phone calls to women before he had been arrested for indecent exposure.
Without David Caldwell's profile, we don't go to the individuals and pull blood from them that knew her, and we're in that close inner circle. So it would have probably taken John and Kenneth Register killing again, which that was another prediction that Mr. Caldwell had made, was the fact that he would have killed again.
When I think about John Kenneth Register, I think about a serial killer. I think that John Register was a serial killer. We just caught him after his first murder.
For the murder of Crystal Todd, John Register will be in prison for the rest of his life.
This DLC program is sponsored in part by America Online. So easy to use, no wonder it's number one.
I've been on America Online 2 months, and it's really been a revelation for me. I thought at my age, oh, am I going to have trouble, Heather?
Just fire up that machine and off you go.
You got mail!
Bling! An instant message pops up. It's having a verbal chat electronically.
I expect to get more and more messages as soon as some of my friends go on America Online. It opened up a new world.
The single most important reason to have America Online is to keep me in touch with the people I love.
16-year-old gets $20 from Grandma. He buys a CD.
It was on sale.
But wait, he's got a date tonight. Solution?
Wendy's 99-cent super value menu. Junior bacon cheeseburgers, baked potatoes, rich and meaty chili. It's there for you.
Problem solved.
Who is that guy?
OfficeMax.com. With over 20,000 items at guaranteed low prices, no wonder more people shop OfficeMax.com.
Paramedics, Monday at 8 on TLC. It's an hour of TV you can't live without.
Monday on TLC. From the capture of dangerous fugitives.
That's the guy.
To the flights of Con Air. The U.S. Marshals arrest and bring to trial America's most notorious criminals.
The worst terrorist act on American soil.
You're under arrest, brother.
DLC follows them to Los Angeles as they hunt down their suspects.
Let's go.
Hands on your head.
U.S. Marshals, hunters and protectors, and inside the L.A. office. Monday at 9 on TLC.
Sometimes it's hard for him to breathe.
I used to use an inhaler to help. Recently, my doctor switched me to a nebulizer.
His doctor said it would be better for him. And it's covered by Medicare. That makes life easier for us.
We found something else that makes life a lot easier. Liberty Medical.
If you use a nebulizer or inhaler to help you breathe and are covered by Medicare, Liberty Medical can make life easier for you, too.
Liberty Medical delivers all his medications right to our door.
And they bill Medicare and our insurance company. We have no upfront costs. And no forms to fill out.
Now we have more time for us.
If you're 65 or older, have emphysema, chronic bronchitis, or asthma, and are covered by Medicare, call the number on your screen for more information about home delivery of nebulizers and respiratory medications from Liberty Medical.
Who wouldn't want more time for the fun things in life?
Profiling the arson case, some people say, well, how can you do it? I mean, you don't have a body. But you do have a body. You do. You have the scene. You have the structure that was burned, the building, the remains of the building. That is your body of your crime.
For 25 years, Gus Gary smoked out arsonists as a special agent for the ATF. He was a veteran of the FBI's intensive 9-month profiling course. But in October of 1992, he faced one of his most difficult cases. Over 50 fires in 3 weeks. A serial arsonist was terrorizing a 60-mile area around Seattle. Weary investigators looked to Gus Gary for help.
When I flew to Seattle and I went over to the task force headquarters, I knew right then this was different. You could tell by talking to them that the pressure was building. The community was afraid. It moved quickly from attacking small, vacant structures, moving up to occupied structures late at night when people are at greatest risk.
The arsonist's pattern was escalating. He increased the size and danger with every blaze. Gus Gary felt like he was following the trail of a phantom.
When you're working on a serial case and you go to one of his fire scenes, sometimes I believe you can feel it. You know he's been there. By what he's done, what he targeted. It's an eerie feeling sometimes to know that there he is. It's him. It's him again.
Almost immediately, Gary felt certain this was the act of a careful, meticulous fire starter.
He spent time over the target, and he would collect from what was available there. He built his fire. It's like starting a campfire. The Seattle arsonist is one of the most organized that I've ever encountered. He falls into the top 10% on the scale.
Attention to detail. It is the hallmark of what investigators categorize as an organized fire starter. This was a vital clue. Gus knew that an organized arsonist almost always has a higher level of education and a sophisticated knowledge of fire setting. Formidable foe, driven by a compulsive need, he would stop at nothing to set larger, more destructive fires.
This offender enjoys the power. He's able to come in into an area where people live, where people move freely. He almost drifts in like a fog, then he disappears.
4 weeks passed, more fires. The toll reached 60 buildings.
When you look at one of these major cases, you'll see what happened to the community. People in fear, people sleeping in churches with shotguns guarding their neighborhoods, armed, particularly when the fires continue and they get bigger and they get bigger and you don't have a suspect. Very stressful.
The media responded by publishing their own profile of the arsonist, the times he struck, who was at risk, what buildings he favored. Gary waited to see the arsonist's reaction.
The fire stopped for a 2-week or so period, and then the fire started again, but they started different times. Instead of late at night, it became very early in the evening, the first 3 or 4 hours of darkness, as opposed to the last 3 or 4 hours of darkness. So he made a change. He reacted to what had come out in the media. Part of that was a message. He wanted everybody to know he was still there. It was kind of like cat and mouse. You hadn't caught me. I'm still here. What are you going to do?
Just days after the newspaper published the profile, the arsonist returned with a vengeance, now setting fires to occupied homes.
I was amazed that nobody had died. Some people barely escape with their lives, with their children. So when he set those fires to those homes as people were asleep,
headed is. He planned to kill them.
Investigators continued to sift through the ruins of more than 70 fires set in the past 3 months. Witnesses gave physical descriptions of possible suspects. Others reported seeing a late model car leaving some of the fires.
If he drove a new, clean car, that may be reflected in other aspects of his dress, his outward appearance, if you will. If he may be neat in appearance about his fire setting, he may be somewhat neat in his appearance.
After 4 months of work, Gary presented the task force with his profile. He surmised that the arsonist was a white male, about 30 years of age. He would be well-dressed and neat in appearance. Because he drove a newer automobile, he would be educated, professional, and the widespread pattern of fires indicated to Gary that the arsonist could likely be a traveling salesman.
And in the end, it's almost like you had a portrait of a man without a face. He had no face. You knew him, but you couldn't identify him. He had no face.
In an unprecedented move, the task force released Gus Gary's profile, along with the three suspect sketches, to the public, in hopes of generating leads.
Within a day after releasing the profile, one of the members of the task force got a call from a gentleman named Mr. George Keller, who told him the family was concerned that it might be his son, Paul Keller, who might be setting these fires. At that time, I think he was 27 years old, that he drove a late model car, that he was an aficionado of the fire service, that he carried a scanner, listened to the fire calls on the radio. And the investigators nodded.
Paul Keller quickly became the investigators' prime suspect. But the task force faced a major obstacle. There was little physical evidence connecting Keller to the fires. So the investigators knew that to get a conviction, they would need a confession. Their interview strategy would have to be flawless.
He liked the fire service. Treat him with respect. Bring him in as such. Let him see a high-ranking official in his uniform. The fire chief in his uniform with his emblems of his office and his stripes. It's a very impressive appearance. And that set the stage, visually set the stage, when Paul came in the door.
I've been waiting.
I know. I'm sorry we couldn't get to you sooner.
That's up.
On February 6, 1993, 6 months after the first fire, Paul Keller was arrested and brought to the task force headquarters to be interviewed. Gary and the others watched from a television monitor down the hall.
You must realize that Keller was under no obligation. As a matter of fact, he didn't have to talk at all. All he had to do was hold up his hand and say, "That's it. I'm not saying a word." But he didn't.
I knew that you guys were hot on the trail.
Let's go back. All right.
And so I'm not trying to make light of it, but I'll tell you, I know you guys are thrilled that I'm sitting here. And I am thrilled to be sitting here. To tell you the truth, I'm glad.
You could hear a pin drop. This was the most tense moment. This was 6 months. Came down to that one question.
In early August, there were three fires involving three structures, houses under construction, called Colin and Clarence, located near where you live. Now, those were your initial fires, from what we understand. You set those fires.
I did.
Big lumber yard, sold primarily doors, nice hardware. Did you set fire to that? Did you set fire to that church?
Yes, I did.
Okay.
And he said, "I'm your man." Great feeling. You could see it. You could see it. This is the home run of home runs in this business.
Am I going to jail?
It all depends. If there's a real possibility that, yes, I won't lie.
It was the amazing accuracy of Gus Gary's profile that made it possible to extinguish a deadly serial arsonist. Gus predicted the arsonist was about 30. Paul Keller was 27 years old. His late model car matched the witness descriptions. Gus felt he would always dress neatly, Keller was as neat as a pin, and as predicted, he worked in advertising sales.
I think profiling is a lot like solving a puzzle, many pieces. Of course, they don't all fit, and they don't always appear as they really are.
Paul Keller admitted to starting 76 fires, including a retirement home which claimed the lives of three elderly women. Investigators believe he may have been connected to hundreds of others. Keller was sentenced to 99 years in prison.
Seville STS. More than just a pretty face. Enhanced with Stabilitrack 2.0, it handles superbly on dry roads, wet roads, and outperforms BMW, Lexus, and Mercedes-Benz. On ice, Seville STS. Sleek styling and powerful control. The power of and. The fusion of design and technology. Cadillac.
Presidential bloopers. The funniest moments of the American presidents.
Two young men, attractive, able, alcoholics. Workaholics.
The president has to be very, very careful with his words.
Masayasu. Masayasu Okumura. Okumura. Oh, damn it.
We're very honored to be back in San Francisco. We're here for a great convention. San Diego, sure. Yeah.
We're trying to get unemployment to go up, and I think we're going to succeed.
What a waste it is to lose one's mind or not to have a mind is being very wasteful.
Start laughing with Presidential Bloopers for just $9.99. Then check out other bloopers videos that you can't buy anywhere else. Stores, so call now and start with Presidential Bloopers for just $9.99.
I feel right at home in this gymnasium.
Get the funniest bloopers ever. Presidential Bloopers.
Call 1-800-803-5511 to order Presidential Bloopers for only $9.99. That's 1-800-803-5511, or send $9.99 plus $3.99 shipping and handling to Presidential Bloopers, Department 3, Richmond, Virginia, 23280. Call now.
Tuesday on Trauma. Sometimes life's roadmap takes an unexpected turn.
They were in a van, and the van was crushed.
One couple, seriously injured in an accident, puts matters into another's hands.
Hope in Jehovah.
What happens when in a crisis?
She's a Jehovah's Witness.
Medicine and religion meet face-to-face inside the ER.
There are patients that we can't save.
An all-new episode of Trauma, Life in the ER, Tuesday at 8 on TLC.
TLC takes you on a race against time. From shock trauma to EMS, meet men and women who battle death and win. With lives on the line, pressure feeds perfection. Critical Incident, next Sunday at 8 on TLC.
Detectives look at what's in the crime and then go forward from that point. What we're trying to do as profilers is to not just focus on the things that are so obvious, but the subtle parts of the crime. You know, the read between the lines, the think outside the box, the non-traditional types of looking at the individual pieces of evidence that are at the crime scene.
As a criminal profiler for the Florida Department of Law Enforcement, Dale Hinman sometimes finds herself a lone voice in the woods, and sometimes disagreeing with her colleagues. On April 25th, 1996, detectives in Crestview, Florida, were called to the scene of a grisly murder. A mother and child were discovered dead in their car. The deceased were identified as 23-year-old Rachel Carlson, an Air Force medical technician, and her 3-month-old daughter, Alexis Stewart. Rachel had been stabbed over 60 times. Alexis had a fatal stab wound to the heart. Within the hour, police were looking for a local drug dealer who was spotted as a passenger in a similar car and lived just a mile away from the crime scene.
When the investigators went to that residence, they also recovered a Marlboro brand cigarette out of the driveway that appeared to be pretty freshly stepped out. And inside the vehicle, the victim's vehicle, was a pack of Marlboro cigarettes. So things started to look like we were going in the right direction pretty quick.
Due to the extreme brutality of the murders, Dale Hinman was called in to assist the investigation. But as she looked at the evidence against the drug dealer, she began to have her doubts.
Just because someone has a criminal past, it's a hard reach to go from a history of minor crimes that don't involve great violence to jump to a person being stabbed this many times and their baby's life being taken at the same time. I've seen a lot of cases that are very similar to this where a mother is killed who has a baby. In each of the cases where a mother's killed and a baby is present, the baby's never injured because the baby can't speak to who the offender is and is not the focus of the attack.
I had heard of profilers before. I knew what they were supposed to do or what they were supposed to be able to do, but never using one myself, I can't say that I had any confidence in a profiler.
If you had this crime and a crazed drug offender did it, then you might have had 3 stab wounds or a cut throat. But why stab the victim over and over and over and then stab the victim's baby? That many stab wounds means a personal involvement.
I could see where she was coming from on some points, but I was still quite sure that we were headed in the right direction with all the points that we had coming together on our suspect.
The police continued to build their case against the drug dealer. Footprints were discovered around the vehicle. They matched the shoe type that the suspect wore.
We had, in actuality, 4 people telling us they saw this particular person in this type of vehicle with a white female with a baby in the back seat that day. That's pretty strong to go on.
I told him that you need to go back and find out who is the father of the child and focus on that person. Their response to this was, I think that some of the people there believed me, and then some of the people who don't know me thought, well, when you have evidence that says a person did it, then the person did it.
Police questioned the infant's father, Walker Davis Jr. Davis was stationed with Carlson at Eglin Air Force Base, where they had worked together. But he had an alibi for the night of the murders, which was backed up by his cousin, Lamar Brooks.
Knowing that the father of the baby and a relative of his alibied each other meant nothing to me because that was too convenient.
Because a baby's murder is such a personal act of violence, Hinman urged detectives to continue the investigation of the baby's father.
I would say that more weight started being put on the profile on what Ms. Hinman had to say on the second day of the investigation.
By then, investigators, despite their initial leads, could find no connection between Rachel Carlson and the drug dealer. They determined that Rachel was an upstanding mother and soldier. She had no record of criminal activity nor drug use. And the police had already ruled out robbery as a motive. So the haunting question remained: why would Rachel Carlson bring her child into a crime-infested neighborhood known for its drug trafficking?
This was a very rural area, and it's an area that the victim wouldn't have come to on her own for some particular reason. She wouldn't have been just driving in this area and happened upon stopping. She wasn't the kind of person that would be in a high-crime area. She wasn't the kind of person who would go out and look for drugs. She was not the kind of person that would expose her baby to what she perceived as being danger.
Dale Hinman's determination convinced detectives to dig deeper into Davis's alibi. What they found out would shift the focus of the investigation.
It was a short period of time, I would say just a matter of hours, that this alibi was pretty much blown out of the water. And that by people that had actually seen him in Crestview.
Police learned that Davis was furious with Rachel Carlson over her plans to garnish his wages for child support. In a dramatic discovery, police found computer email between Davis and Rachel, indicating he had planned to take her and the infant to Crestview on the night they were murdered.
We also found out that the boyfriend, Walker Davis, had taken out a $100,000 double indemnity insurance policy on the child, meaning in case of an accidental death, homicide being accidental, he would collect $200,000.
Walker Davis Jr. and Lamar Brooks were arrested. During their trial, an informant testified that the accused had conspired together to collect on the baby's life insurance policy. The prosecution told the jury that while Davis watched, Lamar Brooks stabbed Rachel Carlson and little Alexis to death. Both men were convicted of first-degree murder. Lamar Brooks was sentenced to death. Walker Davis Jr. received life in prison without the possibility of parole. In an ironic twist, blood tests revealed that Davis was not the baby's father.
If you don't really believe in what you do, and if you don't really care about these victims, and if you don't really care that this baby that never had a chance to go to kindergarten and be on a teeter-totter and swing and be with her family and her grandmother and her mother, how can you really do this job if you don't really care about these people and about their future and the fact that they're not going to be here anymore?
3 minutes from now, a heart attack victim will be rushed into this emergency room. Medication will be injected. IV fluids will be needed. The patient will be protected from infection. Breathing will be assisted. And one more life will be saved.
Mrs. Hansen?
Yes.
I'm Dr. Moore. Her husband's doing fine.
Oh, I'm so glad.
Thanks to advanced medical techniques and a material we call plastic.
Everybody's got their own way of loving Sonic's tater tots. Right now, get a Sonic burger and a load of hot, crispy tots for a special low price. You'll love the way we do things.
Sonic America's driving.
To me, this isn't a hobby or even a sport. It's an obsession. So if I can't get out to this exact spot at this exact time of year, I may as well be bowling.
Get out there, an expedition from your Ford Outfitter. Outfitting you with the most far-reaching sport utilities on earth. Ford Outfitters, no boundaries.
When the moon is in the seventh house, Jupiter aligns with Mars. Peace will guide the planets, and love will steer the stars. It's a whole new age of consumer power. With Priceline.com, millions of beautiful people have named their own price and saved a load of bread on the things they want and need. Can you dig it? Age of Aquarius. Aquarius.
Get inside the minds of daredevils.
I broke so many bones in my body. What's a couple collarbones?
Con men.
Anyone can get conned. Anyone can get fooled.
There's just no view like it. Inside the Minds, coming up next.
Stevie Wonder, at the close of a century. The brand new collection that pays tribute to one of the most influential American musicians of his generation. Stunning sound, all tracks digitally remastered from original sources, including Uptight, Master Blaster, Golden Lady, I Just Called to Say I Love You, and more. This deluxe 4-CD retrospective comes with a 96-page full-color booklet packed with essays and rare photos. Over 5 hours of music from one of the most prolific singer-songwriters of our time. Stevie Wonder, at the close of a century. To order the Stevie Wonder at the close of a century 4-CD set, use your credit card and call the number on your screen or send check or money order for $59.98 or two easy installments for $29.99 plus shipping and handling to the address shown. Rush delivery is available, so call now.
Of course, in the world of a profiler, the bizarre, it becomes almost mundane because we see very strange things on a daily basis. To consider that a mother would kill her own children was not out of the question for me. certainly in my career and in the career of many investigators, we've encountered mothers that kill their own children.
October 25th, 1994. An anxious resident in rural South Carolina called 911.
Mm-hmm. Okay, there's a lady. Some guy jumped into a red light with her car with her two kids in it, and he took off, and she got out of the car here at Ohio.
The caller stated that a frantic woman had rushed to his house, claiming that a man had forced her from her vehicle and kidnapped her two sons before speeding away. The woman was Susan Smith. With her estranged husband by her side, she made a public plea to the kidnapper.
I would like to say to whoever has my children that they please bring them home.
Across America, hearts went out to the desperate mother. Police began a massive manhunt. They also placed a call to criminal profiler David Caldwell.
How many phone calls do you think you made the next morning?
I interviewed Susan Smith. She appeared to be creating the story as we went. Certainly very dramatic was as she told me the story, and she got to the part to where she's being forced from the car and relinquishing the wheel to the alleged kidnapper, there was no change in her emotion. Now, how many parents could reach that point in such a story and not come apart?
Your mama loves you so much.
Quite often when you're talking to someone who's not really a victim, but is merely claiming to be a victim, will cry at inappropriate times and fail to cry when they should. Certainly inappropriate smiling. Susan would smile at times when anyone whose children had been kidnapped that night would find it impossible to smile. Those smiles and even some almost laughter ran chills up my neck. I said, this didn't happen. This could not have happened the way she describes it.
I thought that either she had taken her children and hidden them somewhere for some reason unknown to me, or it crossed my mind that they may be dead.
Hours later, police found a letter from a young man breaking off his relationship with Susan. In it, he wrote, "There are some things about you that aren't suited for me, and yes, I am speaking about your children. The fact is, I just don't want children."
I did not have anything to do with the abduction of my children.
When I would see Susan making these appeals on national media, I would be thinking, this has got to end soon. We need this to end.
It's very painful to have the finger pointed at you when it's your children involved.
November 3rd, 1994, 9 days after the disappearance of her children, Susan Smith was again interrogated by the police. They confronted her with the mounting number of inconsistencies in her story and threatened to expose them to the media. Finally, she confessed.
Susan Smith has been arrested and will be charged with 2 counts of murder in connection with the deaths of her children, Michael 3 and Alexander 14 months.
We all felt so much relief at that moment that, yes, now this investigation is over. And that relief then turned into sickening horror when we were there at the side of the pond having a wrecker pull her car out of that pond and seeing those two little boys inside. No one can look upon such a scene as that and not be moved. It's a vision that I certainly will never forget. How could someone do this to their own children? And even though I'd been trained in the dark psychopathology of the human mind, it still seemed incomprehensible to me.
Susan Smith was convicted of murdering her two sons. She is currently serving a life sentence.
Owens, Corning presents A Queen Sweep.
Mirror, mirror, etc. Who's the fairest in the land?
In the forest, there lies a cottage with the most beautiful Owens Corning Oak Ridge Deep Shadow roof.
Yes,
with shingles so durable, they're warranted for 40 years.
Well?
Well, Queenie, there's always Miss Congeniality.
For the full story on all our incredibly durable roofing systems, call us or visit owenscorning.com today. Owens Corning, the stuff dream homes are made of.
To build the new LeSabre, we didn't just look to research numbers or test scores. We also took a good look at your family. Introducing the all-new 2000 LeSabre, re-engineered with more safety features than any other car in its class. Stand by. The new 2000 LeSabre by Buick.
Jack is generous.
What can I say?
Even when it comes to himself, but he might have overdone it. Solution?
Till he pays off the TV, Wendy's 99-cent super value menu with chili, chicken nuggets, baked potatoes, it's there for you.
You know, I've seen this.
So go home.
What are your favorite moments of the millennium? A special time with family? A celebration with friends? Or one of mankind's greatest journeys? Now you can have them all on one special Kodak Picture CD that's yours free. It contains all your Kodak pictures from your latest roll of film, plus excerpts from life's collection of the greatest pictures of the 20th century. Look for this free, limited-time offer at participating Kodak retailers.
If you're ready to lose weight, muscle up, and get back into shape, I've got a free video you're gonna love.
Introducing a winning fitness strategy.
You gotta eat healthy, drink plenty of water, and most importantly, strength train with Bowflex.
Strength training adds muscle. Not only does your shape look better, you actually increase your metabolism.
Hey, I'm 41, and I'm in the best shape of my life. And I can tell you, Bowflex really does work.
For a free video and brochure on the machine that can help you get into great shape at any age, call right now.
Get inside the minds of daredevils.
I broke so many bones in my body. What's a couple collarbones?
Con men.
Anyone can get conned. Anyone can get fooled.
There's just no view like it. Inside the Minds, coming up next.
Paramedics, Monday at 8 on TLC. From the capture of dangerous fugitives...
That's the guy.
...to the flights of Con Air, the U.S. Marshals arrest and bring to trial America's most notorious criminals. U.S. Marshals, Monday at 9 on TLC.
The CIA has thousands of untold stories. Sunday, the files are being opened.
Most people in this country could not possibly know how many World Trade Center bombings would have occurred if we weren't doing our jobs.
See the secret training facility, The Farm. Get details on a declassified daring prison rescue.
We are, in fact, the Shadow Warriors.
Go on the inside of the world's most guarded organization. Inside the CIA, Sunday at 8 Eastern and Pacific on the Discovery Channel.
Prostitutes murdered in Riverside. That's it. That's all I know. My question is, how many? We think we have 8. When did they start? I've got the dates. When was the last one? I've got the date. That's it. That's what I have to work on.
On June 26, 1989, the body of a young woman was discovered, strangled, in a remote section of Riverside County, California. She was the sixth in a series of brutal homicides in the past 3 years. The victims were all female and all prostitutes. Officials realized that they were in the clutches of a deadly serial killer. Mike Pradhan got the call and began to retrace the killer's steps.
We had some of the victims dumped in behind industrial areas, behind businesses, near dumpsters. See, I got a main road and I got a freeway. Okay, I can come off the main road, I can come on off the freeway onto the main road, I can come down this street. Comfortable to be able to get in and out of there and dump the body. I got no people in the nighttime. Pull in, pull out, stop the car, body goes out, back in the car, up a half a block, out and around, and I'm back on the freeway in what 2 minutes, 3 minutes? The idea that in the dumpster, near the dumpster, that this woman is trash, this woman is not worth anything, just discard it and walk away. What are the odds of trying to find a guy in that period of time while he's dumping a body? You can't do it. There's too many places like this in any community. So the idea was, You're not going to find him where he's dumping the body. You're going to find him where he's picking up the victims to begin with.
Mike Pradhan had few clues and very little evidence. He knew that in order to catch this killer, he had to see him through his victim's eyes.
Women had probably dealt with him before, either had conversations with him before, or even had sex with him before, and there wasn't a problem. He is not a stranger to them. When the word is out that there's someone out there killing prostitutes, they're looking for the stranger. They're looking for the guy they've never dated before. If this guy was such a dangerously looking person, either by his physical appearance or by his immediate interaction with the women, what would happen? None of them would get in the car with him. None. So when he pulled up to engage them in conversations for another date, they believe that, well, this wasn't the guy. And they get in the car, and then something goes wrong, and they were chosen now to die.
February 8, 1990. Victim number 10 is discovered in a garbage dumpster. Mike Pradhan could see that the level of violence was increasing.
The more screwed up the sexual fantasies, the more violent it is, the more likely it is a white guy. I mean, it's not very scientific, it's not probably backed up with a tremendous amount of research, but it's just our experience. I mean, it's what we've seen before. I don't feel like I'm getting into his mind, but I feel I can understand his mind. He's able to interact with these women, he's able to trick them, he's able to fool them, he's able to gain their confidence. So you ask yourself, is that the work of a 16-year-old kid? No, it's not. It's got to be someone who's got a little bit older, a little bit more mature.
November 6, 1990. 4 years after the first murder, victim number 11. But with every murder came another clue, another piece of the puzzle. Mike Pradhan formulated his profile.
He's white, he's male, late 20s, early 30s. He's got a car that doesn't stand out. I mean, it's not going to be a real fancy car. It's going to be a working car. It's going to be a van, something with privacy. His work's going to be blue collar. He's going to be married. Marriage's going to be in turmoil. It's not going to be a real close one. He can come and go as he pleases all hours without causing too much consternation in his personal life.
6 weeks later, the 12th murder. And the killer's behavior has taken an even more sadistic turn.
The murders had more of a spontaneous nature to them. There was more blunt force trauma, there were some cutting injuries and the like. The killings were manual and ligature strangulation, and then post-mortem mutilation of the bodies.
January 19th, 1991. Victim number 13 is discovered by passing motorists. April 26th. Victim number 14 is found in a vacant lot. July 4th, victim number 15 is horribly mutilated.
But he's already in his 12th, 13th, 14th kill. His confidence level has gone up. I mean, I've gotten away with it 15 times, so why shouldn't I take my time and do more things with the body? They haven't caught me yet. I mean, they've got this task force looking for me, but they haven't caught me. Well, in a sense, you're matching wits, but look at it more of like a chess game. He makes a move, then we make a move. So the pressure comes upon me, comes upon the profiler, to come up with something. If you give up, if you get frustrated, if you get disheartened, then this guy's won. This is where you have to be confident in your profile. You got to be confident that you've got him on the right track, that you're right, that what you're doing is going to catch this guy, and you can only hope that you're going to be able to catch this guy so you can wrap him up before someone else dies.
1 month later, the killer strikes again. This time, tire tracks and carpet fibers are found at the scene. Forensic experts match the treads to that of a truck or van. It looked as if the task force was finally gaining ground. But then, the investigation was thrown off balance when a newspaper published its own profile of the killer.
They said that, well, since all the victims were white, which wasn't correct, and white guys only kill white victims, therefore our guy's a white guy. Well, I know that these individuals watch the media to see how close we're getting, so now that puts them at risk, because the cops are not going to look for Asians or Hispanics or African Americans. They're only going to look for white guys. So I called the investigators and said, the next victim is not going to be white. It's going to be a minority of some type. And sure enough, the next victim turned out to be a female black prostitute.
the grisly murders continued. Mike Prodan released his profile to investigators. He speculated that the killer would be a 35-year-old white male. He would be local to Riverside County. He would be a non-threatening and familiar face to the local prostitutes. He would be driving a van. He would have a low-key job, accountable to no one. Prodan's profile was now in the hands of every law enforcement agency in Riverside County. All they needed was a break.
The whole purpose of the profile at this point in the investigation is for me to paint a picture so that when the officer sees a possible suspect, in other words, a male with a street prostitute in conversation, does this guy fit?
On January 9th, 1992, police officers pulled over a van driven by a 41-year-old man named William Suff. He fit the profile.
He was doing exactly what we said he would be doing. He was conversing with a known prostitute on the street, gets in his car and makes a traffic violation. The officer pulls him over. He matches the information that had been put out at the briefings. Detectives come out, preliminary interview. He still matches. Call out the crime lab. The vehicle and the tires match. Record check comes back. He's wanted from Texas on parole violation on a murder charge. That gets him in custody. And once he's in custody, everything now falls into place.
In the end, it was the amazing accuracy of the profile that enabled the police to focus the investigation and make an arrest in the case.
We said male, of course he was male. White matched. The age matched. He was married, but it was a tumultuous relationship. He could come and go as he pleased. He had a criminal history of violence. He had the arrest in Texas was for beating his own child to death when the child was an infant. We said that he would have one of these invisible jobs. As it turns out, this guy was working for the county of Riverside in a warehouse where some of the women were sentenced for work furlough for their prostitution convictions. So they were seeing him in two different places. They were seeing him at work, where he wasn't a problem, and they were seeing him on the street where he wasn't a problem, so why wouldn't they get in the car with him?
The 5-year reign of terror ended when William Suff was convicted of the murders. He is now on death row in San Quentin Prison.
You know that by apprehending them, you've saved other people. You've kept him from hurting people. So there is this elation, if you would, this sense of accomplishment that you've had a small part in keeping people from being hurt. The regrets are that you couldn't do it sooner.
Sadly, we will probably never eliminate all violent crime, never put an end to all murders. But while there is a small population of corrupted souls willing to kill, they are being hunted by a small group of profilers who are willing to immerse themselves in the dark side of the human spirit, to spend countless hours scrutinizing, dissecting, merging with the criminal mind.
Profiling is understanding the motivations of why people do horrible, violent things, but then taking that understanding and, if you would, twist it in a way to use it against them so you can find these people.
Taking the journey into the darkness of the criminal mind sometimes absolutely exhausts me. There are weeks when I just want to sit down in the quiet and not think at all. I am now and have always been fascinated with human behavior, and I absolutely love applying an understanding of human behavior to getting those sons of bitches off the street.
They shrug off fear, defy death, and call it fun. Take a look in the mind of daredevils and see what makes them tick next on TLC. And for adventures for your mind online, log on to TLC.com.
Con men, swindlers, tricksters, sucker for every last dime. Everywhere you turn, a con man is taking advantage of someone, creating lies that fool even the most skeptical among us. The con man maneuvers through a secret world of deception, rarely revealing his true nature to anyone but his own kind. But tonight, several have come out from the shadows to reveal their secrets. They confirm the con man is a predatory criminal, driven by much more than greed, living in an artificial world where nothing is quite what it seems.
Everyone I've met in prison that have conned someone or scammed someone and wound up in prison for it couldn't wait till their release date so they could get out and do it again.
This is Brett Champion, a reformed con artist who began pulling scams at the age of 15. We convinced him to reveal the tricks of his trade and to demonstrate a classic con. Why would a successful con artist reveal his secrets? According to Brett, he's now gone straight, and this is all part of his new fraud prevention program.
I had a telemarketing operation of my own where we were selling shares in oil wells that didn't exist. And the FBI finally came in and shut us down, and Brett Champion had to do 3 years in federal prison. While I was in prison, I decided I don't want to be a 50-year-old man conning people. So I thought, how can I take this negative situation and turn it into a positive situation?
Brett used his time behind bars to write a best-selling book on fraud prevention. After his release, Champion promoted himself as a scam expert, educating the public on how to protect themselves from con artists.
Can we go? Is she ready? I want to go right now. Can we go? Are you ready?
I'm ready.
Ready, Bob?
Uh-huh.
Okay, let's go. Action.
Using hidden cameras at a posh Los Angeles restaurant, Brett Champion staged a classic con known as the Ring Scam. Brett is hoping to fool a greedy bar patron into buying an expensive-looking ring the patron believes to be extremely valuable. Brett hired this actress as his partner in crime. Here, she sets up the victims.
I lost a ring. It's a big wedding ring. It's a, it's 3 carats. It's worth about $35,000. If you guys, I'm so sorry to bother you guys like this. Can I give you my name and number? And just, I have $2,000 cash I can give you if you guys can find it.
Sure.
My God, I don't believe it. Take a look at this.
There was a lady here.
Some lady was just
looking for that.
Here, looking for that.
Yeah.
Enter Brett Champion, who flashes an expensive-looking ring. When a man at the bar shows interest, Champion preys upon his greed.
If you want this ring, you got to give me something for it. I'll give you the ring. You can do whatever you want with it.
Just here. How much?
I don't know. It's probably worth thousands of dollars.
How much you want?
$500.
The ring, of course, is practically worthless. Who is the victim of the con? The man who is paying the $500, right? Wrong. We were. When Brett Champion set up this hidden camera scam, he assured our producers that only he and the actress would be part of the operation. Later, he admitted that both the bartender and the man who paid the money were also part of his scam. In short, Brett Champion conned us.
And the reason I deceived the TLC production staff was to show that anyone can get conned, anyone can get fooled, not just the average person on the street. And we succeeded. The way I look at it is if one person watches this television show and learns how not to become victimized by fraud, I feel that I've done my job to help society. I hated the old Brett Champion because he did the wrong thing, because he broke the law, because he went against his morals, and because he hurt other people.
But the story doesn't end there. Just 4 weeks after this interview, Brett Champion, who said he had gone straight, was arrested for telemarketing fraud. Champion's real name is Stephen Robert Commissar. According to official reports, he was accused of selling phony investments over the phone, having already served 2 jail terms. If Champion is convicted on all charges, he could end up serving 80 years in jail.
Being a con man is a lonely, sleazy, dirty, filthy existence. It's almost like sticking a needle full of heroin in your arm.
In other words, Commissar's whole performance as Brett Champion, repentant con artist, may have been in itself just another scam. Welcome to the confusing world of the con man, a complicated network of lies, double dealings, and ever-shifting realities that go on around us every day.
Anybody can fall victim to a scam, and it's just a matter of finding the right one for you.
It's the crime of the future because law enforcement has not caught up to it. They think that they're the elite criminal. They look down on people who have to use a gun in order to get money.
I'm really just the worst example of what's wrong with America today.
And they enjoy the hunt, they enjoy the game of going after the people, and at the end, they all want them to end up with the victim smiling, going, please take my money, please.
It's a challenge to make more money than your sister-in-law, than your sister, than your mother-in-law.
I have to get caught. If I don't get caught, nobody will know I did it. Do you understand?
There was no thought about stopping. There was that this is what I do.
For some, like Jake Stone, the life of a con man is the only life he's ever known. Now serving 16 years in prison for insurance fraud, Jake was trained by his family as a slip and fall artist.
All con games are psychological. You have to use your head. You have to second guess somebody. You have to know what action is going to cause what reaction.
Although Jake has little formal education, he is well schooled in the science of deception. Here is how he was able to outsmart the experts. The slip and fall swindle involves staging a fall, faking an injury, and bilking insurance companies for huge financial settlements. Knowing he would face close scrutiny at every turn, Jake became a pro at making his cons convincing.
First you'd walk into a store and look. First thing, of course, you'd look for is security cameras. That's your best witness. Then you don't need a witness, an actual physical witness. Then it's taking your trip down the aisles.
The critical element for the slip and fall artist is the opportunity to fall. Because this is an insurance scam, the cause of the accident must be created by the store's employees.
I go a couple aisles down, I spot something at the end of that aisle. I know they created that, so that's going to be 100% negligence on their part.
The show is about to begin.
It's like a little play, a performance, where you have to be the actor, the professional stunt person, and the choreographer. So you set the stage. You don't have a second take, so you make the shot count.
Jake calmly approaches the hazard on the floor and makes his fall convincing. As if right on cue, employees and other witnesses come quickly to his aid. Now seeming to be in pain, Jake struggles to stand up.
Finally, I can get up onto my feet, but there's a lot of pain, but I think I'll be okay. So I tell the manager, Jim, I'm going to go home and, you know, see how I feel and get some rest, and I'll let you know how I am. Of course, whenever you have an injury, an hour after you have the injury, it's going to hurt considerably more than it did when you fell. So on the way home, it got so severe that I couldn't take it anymore, so I had to go to the nearest hospital.
Having easily fooled the store manager, Jake now faces his most difficult adversary, the doctor. Jake has to convince hospital personnel not only that his injury is serious, but that it warrants hospitalization.
Once you're in the hospital, they come out with the wheelchair. As soon as you go to stand up to get into the wheelchair, the leg goes out. If the leg goes out, then you've got some problems. If the leg goes out, that means that you're probably got some type of damage in your vertebrae or the discs, like a herniated ruptured disc. So that's the first thing they're going to think of.
Jake anticipates any sophisticated medical tests like MRIs and CAT scans by faking this specific back injury because he knows it will escape their detection.
There's a couple tests that they can do, physical tests that they can do with you to tell if you're faking it, but the professional knows. You get past those, you're fine. Like a chess game where you're maybe five moves ahead of your opponent. You know what he's going to do, but it's just setting those moves up.
After being admitted to the hospital, Jake carefully plans his weekend.
Pain increases, say, from Friday night to Saturday. Saturday, it's so intense you can't take it. You're going to get more medication, because more medication means more pain, which means more money.
By Sunday night, Jake's pain has magically subsided. He's fooled the doctors into allowing him to leave the hospital with only a back brace. Throughout the scam, the rush for Jake is very clear.
It's all up here. If you learn it up here, It doesn't matter how far you've gotten in school, what type of education you have. If you have it up in here, you can manipulate the best. Doing the insurance scams, I got the scam. The witnesses, the business, the insurance company, the doctors, the lawyers. I got to scam everybody. And that was the excitement. The person that taught me had a sixth grade education. Now you're going after somebody that's got years of college. And then a whole bunch of years in their practice. I mean, these people are supposed to be professionals. And you're laughing at them because you're manipulating. You're playing with them. And it is a game. It's a big game. But a game that's extremely profitable.
Now that he's manipulated the store manager and the medical professionals, the last step is the insurance adjuster.
Now the adjuster knows he's already got the claim. 100% negligence, 100% liability means even if they took it to litigation, they're probably going to lose. It's going to cost them time and money. And then boom, there's a check for $10,000, $12,000, $15,000. And you're talking maybe a week, 10 days after you've taken the fall. So it's a pretty profitable little game.
According to Jake Stone, he spent over 30 years successfully playing the slip and fall game before being incarcerated. Looking back at his con man career, he admits that his sense of morality had been turned inside out.
I didn't choose the insurance field. The insurance field was chosen for me because I was a natural at it. Then it was exciting. It was a thrill. It was a challenge. Because the more money that I was able to con out of an insurance company, the more attention I got from my family. It was just the pats on the back, the hugs. You know, I love you. Come here, you've done a great job. And for a kid, I mean, you're looking at 9 or 10 years old. For a kid of that age to be pulled in, I mean, that was a good feeling. I knew reality, but I knew a photo negative, reverse image in the mirror, black is white is black. And I didn't know. I mean, I know what felt right, but what felt right wasn't necessarily what was right.
What sets them apart from you and I is that from the day they're born, they're brought up in an entirely different atmosphere than you and I are. I mean, they're taught and shown in many cases that stealing and lying is acceptable. And I think if you were to be brought up in that lifestyle, that you would think it's okay too.
Monday on Paramedics.
The hole in the windshield is where the head went into it.
In the super fast world of chopper medics, every minute is critical.
That's us, folks.
They risk their lives to save yours. Paramedics, Monday at 8, only on TLC.
For the new LeSabre didn't just come from a research center or design facility. It also came from your family. Introducing the all-new 2000 LeSabre, re-engineered with more safety features than any other car in its class. The new 2000 LeSabre by Buick.
Shopping for office supplies is easy at OfficeMax. Shop by fax, by phone, on the internet at OfficeMax.com, or the good old-fashioned way, by foot. Whichever way you choose, we go to the max for you.
Oh, I feel like I'm 18 again.
Yeah, me too. You'd think I'd feel awful after blowing out retirement money.
What?
Yeah, it's gone.
All of it?
Yeah, I decided to invest our money by myself.
What are we gonna live on?
Hey, fresh air, sunshine, what else do we need? You know, money is highly overrated.
Next time, don't go it alone. Ask your financial advisor about the fund so many financial experts choose. Alliance Capital, the investment professional's choice.
Now get the Wall Street Journal delivered for 13 weeks at just 57 cents a day, a 25% savings.
Call now, 800-754-4400. That's 800-754-4400 for the Wall Street Journal.
Monday on TLC, from the capture of dangerous fugitives,
that's the guy.
To the flights of Con Air, the U.S. Marshals arrest and bring to trial America's most notorious criminals.
The worst terrorist act on American soil.
You're under arrest, brother.
TLC follows them to Los Angeles as they hunt down their suspects.
Let's go.
Hands on your head.
U.S. Marshals, hunters and protectors, and inside the L.A. office. Monday at 9 on TLC.
Take the magic of Disney
and add a splash of water. Embark on a magical land and sea adventure. Just call 1-800-257-4242 for your free Disney Cruise Line vacation video and discover the cruise line that put magic and wonder in the water. A Disney cruise vacation begins with Walt Disney World Fantasy and Fun, where you can be part of our year-long millennium celebration. Then you'll set sail on an enchanted voyage. The video takes you on board, where everyone in the family will discover a world created just for them. Secret hideaways for adults. And playgrounds to delight a child's imagination. You'll sail to the Bahamas and Disney's private island paradise, Castaway Key. The video makes it easy to create your own dream vacation for as low as $8.29. Call 1-800-257-4242 today and discover uncharted magic.
Very exciting to have this kind of power over people. It's phenomenal.
John, let's stop going round and round. Are you interested in making money, honestly?
Whoa, I guess everybody's interested in making money.
Well, let's find out, John.
What you're hearing is an actual scam, tape recorded by this con man, who we'll call Steve Michaels. His specialty is telemarketing. Here, he's attempting to convince John, a man he has never met, to buy a gold coin worth $300. Michaels is selling the coin for an unbelievable $3,000. For the first 2 minutes, Steve plays the role of the concerned advisor.
In your investment portfolio, do you have any numismatic rare coins?
No.
Well then, John, please, you're not being as prudent as you should be.
Every year, billions of dollars are stolen over the phone by people like Steve Michaels. Up until recently, Michaels used this tape to train other phone gangsters. Now, he'll use it to reveal his tricks of the trade.
Penny for penny and dollar for dollar, you are going to be hard-pressed to show this kind of return on any other investment vehicle over the next 3 years.
When Michaels began his telemarketing scams, he enjoyed the challenge of making money selling nothing. So he sold non-existent commodity options, then bogus lottery tickets for federal oil and gas rights. He was able to swindle investors out of tens of thousands of dollars.
I was able to hide behind the telephone. I could be whoever I wanted to be over the phone. I didn't have the confidence that I could do that in person. I only have a 9th grade education. I was a stutterer until the age of 15, and I thought the American dream was just passing me right on by. I really didn't think I had many options in life, so I always saw myself as living an underground kind of an existence. And that really was the motivation for me.
Michaels usually made his calls from sparsely furnished offices with dozens of telephone lines called boiler rooms.
I don't have the liquid boiler right now because...
John, stop it. Now, please, I'm not going to listen to that. That's silly. John, I am not going to pretend that you don't have $3,000. That's silly.
I reduced my victims to voices. They were not moms. They were not dads. They weren't uncles and aunts and grandparents. They were just voices. They didn't exist.
No, I'm not buying this coin right now.
Yes, you are. You're buying this coin. Yes, you are.
$3,100.
That's correct. $3,135.
Phone gangsters find victims in much the same manner that lawyers select juries. We take people through a question and answer session. You go out hunting for people who have these three character traits: greed, gullibility, and who can be controlled. And if you find these three character traits in one person, it's as if you hit the trifecta at Santa Anita. You hit Superlotto, and the sky is the limit.
It wasn't long before Steve realized that John was exactly the kind of person he was looking for.
Believe me, conservatively speaking, there's no doubt in my mind that this coin the next 3 years will be trading in the $6,000 range. Now, come on, seriously.
The first signal that I remember picking up on was the fact that he had nervous laughter, and even he was a bit of a stutterer. And that suggested to me that he was not comfortable with confrontations and would eventually defer to an authoritative figure.
What medication are you on?
Bible, I guess.
On the Bible? Okay. Well, you're going to reap what you sow, John.
At one point, he introduced religion into the conversation. And that really got my attention. Because now I had a true believer on the other end of the phone.
You know what my dad told me that we practice when we practice procrastination? We practice the work of the devil.
Well, I'm not procrastinating my...
Oh, yes, you are. You are procrastinating.
Just what I think is I'd rather have it someplace else.
Well, you're wrong. You're making a mistake, John.
intimidated him. I knew which buttons to push, and I did intimidate him and manipulate him and played with his emotions. It's about total control. That's what this call was about.
You can pay for this coin using a major credit card or a personal check. Which would you prefer?
Well, to tell you the truth right now, I couldn't make up my mind.
Okay, then I'll make up your mind for you. You're going to buy this coin.
Remarkably, after 26 minutes with Steve Michaels, John still has not hung up the phone.
Go get your Visa card. Now stop it. Go get the card.
Well, there's no way you can make me to go and get it because I'm not going to go and get it.
John, do you want to make money, yes or no?
Well, yes.
I gave him plenty of opportunity to hang up. If you remember, I threatened to hang up on him.
Look, I'm going to hang up this phone.
And I just kept coming back, and I kept coming back, and I kept coming back. And I just kept taking control.
All right, go get the card.
Maybe I should give it a shot and see what happens.
All right, go get the card.
In the end, Steve Michaels convinced John that the gold coin was a once-in-a-lifetime investment opportunity.
Congratulations, John.
I hope what you say is true.
All right, John. Bye-bye. You're welcome. Bye-bye.
This guy, in my opinion, was a victim of a drive-by verbal assault. This man said no to me 27 times. But I was undeterred.
Many victims will say things like, you know, they must have hypnotized me. They must have gave me drugs. And you'll hear that frequently from victims. They'll say that. Well, I think what that shows me is they weren't hypnotized. They weren't given drugs. I think that's how good these people are.
Steve Michaels readily admits that what makes him so successful is his predatory nature.
One day, a few years back, I'm holding the door open for a lady entering a building, older lady. And she walks in, thank you, you're welcome. And I remember saying to myself, if I had this woman on the phone, I'd bury her.
The psychopathic con relates to people as prey, where he takes on the role of predator.
A lot of them feel it's actually a game, I think, to them. And they enjoy the hunt, they enjoy the game of going after the people. And at the end, they all want them to end up with the victim smiling, going, please take my money, please.
Ultimately, Steve Michaels' gold coin scam was closed down by the Federal Trade Commission and local law enforcement officials. But Michaels served no jail time.
I was not arrested, and that's part of the problem. The fact that I'm talking to you from behind a microphone instead of from behind prison bars is the problem. I'm really just the worst example of what's wrong with America today. I had the ethics of a wrestling referee. Issues of right and wrong did not matter to me. What mattered to me was the money. The war was just to exterminate you financially.
Steve Michaels is still using his talent as a telemarketer, but claims he's given up his life of crime. Michaels says these days his company only deals in legitimate goods and services.
Miss Johnson. Miss Johnson, it's time for your massage, Miss Johnson.
Solara. An entirely different kind of Camry. It's for you.
With all that stuff you carry around, ever had trouble finding the one thing you need? Like an important receipt or your bank card. Now you can find all your cards and receipts instantly with the amazing Magic Wallet. Is your wallet bursting at the seams? Do you resort to this? You need the Magic Wallet. The Magic Wallet is thin, compact, good-looking, and made of top-quality leather. But watch closely, because you're about to see what makes the Magic Wallet different than any other. Simply put your cash or a receipt inside, close the wallet, and presto, it's magically grabbed and held tight under the strong nylon straps. The Magic Wallet instantly grabs parking stubs, business cards, credit card receipts, and more, so you'll know just where to find them later. But that's not all. These outside pockets hold all your credit cards, driver's license, and more conveniently and securely. And the Magic Wallet still stays thin and streamlined, so it fits easily in your shirt pocket, pants pocket, evening bag, anywhere. The Magic Wallet is handsome, convenient, and fun. Your friends will love it. There's no other wallet like it. It's magic. Old-fashioned wallets and money clips made of high-quality leather like the Magic Wallet can cost $40, $80, even $100. Yet they can't do this. but the genuine leather Magic Wallet costs just $14.95. Plus, you'll get a special free bonus when you call now. Our exclusive auto wallet to hold and organize all your car registration and insurance papers. It's yours free when you order Magic Wallet now. Magic Wallets make great gifts. Call within the next 10 minutes and get two for just $19.95. You save $9.95. And get an auto wallet free. Here's how to order.
Call 1-800-480-1122 now to get the amazing Magic Wallet at the special TV price of just $14.95 and get the auto wallet free. Or get two Magic Wallets for just $19.95 and save even more. Satisfaction guaranteed or your money back. Call now 1-800-480-1122. 1-800-480-1122.
Tuesday on Trauma. Sometimes life's roadmap takes an unexpected turn.
They were in a van and the van was crushed.
One couple seriously injured in an accident puts matters into another's hands.
Hope in Jehovah.
What happens when in a crisis?
She's a Jehovah's Witness.
Medicine and religion meet face to face inside the ER.
There are patients that we can't save.
An all-new episode of Trauma, Life in the ER, Tuesday at 8 on TLC.
Forgive me for placing myself in the same sentence with such a great man as Martin Luther King. But I, too, had a dream.
This is John Bennett Jr. addressing his public. But he's not sharing his vision for the future. In this tape, he's apologizing for his past.
Please hear me when I say I never intended to hurt any one of you. I know that I've done that, however, and I'm so sorry.
If all successful con artists are basically illusionists, John Bennett Jr. could be considered the Houdini of the big con. John Bennett described himself to friends as just a poor kid from Olney, a working-class section of Philadelphia. He was known as a name-dropper, and Bennett's closest friends claim that he had a lifelong fascination with the rich and famous. In 1989, Bennett found a way to enter Philadelphia's high society. He created the Foundation for New Era Philanthropy.
Understand that many foundations are interested in seeing dreams come true. We want to invest in dreams.
The pitch was simple. Let New Era hold your money for 6 months, after which a group of anonymous wealthy benefactors would match the donation dollar for dollar. The result was that nonprofit groups could double their money thanks to John Bennett and New Era.
As it was stated in one of my favorite films, A Field of Dreams, I believed deeply if I build it, they would come. And indeed they were coming.
One of the early participants Bennett contacted was Reverend Glenn Blossom, who had been acquainted with John for years as a fundraiser in nonprofit circles.
We raised something like $500,000 to $600,000 and placed that with New Era at the time. And 6 months later, received that money matched.
After seeing his $500,000 quickly turn into $1 million, Blossom raised more money that was also matched. He happily spread the news to other financially strapped nonprofit groups across the country.
I saw this as a great opportunity. I was privileged, and I always expressed to Jack my great appreciation for his making this available to a number of Christian organizations.
As the reputation of New Era grew, entrance to the world of the wealthy social elite opened up to John Bennett. Bennett had a superb business reputation and listed among his closest associates Lawrence Rockefeller and former Secretary of the Treasury William E. Simon. Through New Era, many organizations doubled their money, but some participants still worried that the offer was too good to be true.
And I said to Jack, there are some people who say this sounds like a Ponzi scheme. And he said to me, what is a Ponzi scheme? And I said, it is using new money to pay off the old debt and continuing that cycle. He said, absolutely not. Those were his words. I can see it as though it were yesterday. Absolutely not.
To those unfamiliar with the world of classic cons, the Ponzi scheme was named after one of the most ingenious men ever associated with financial fraud, Carlo Ponzi. In 1920, he claimed to have found a flaw in the international financial system, enabling anyone to make a fast fortune. With his Ponzi plan, he offered a 50% return on investments in just 3 months. Word spread about this amazing opportunity, and Ponzi had scores of willing investors. What no one knew, of course, was that the Ponzi plan simply used new investments to pay off the interest on the old investments, the classic pyramid scheme. Authorities soon caught on to Ponzi's scam, and he spent 4 years in prison for fraud. But with Carlo Ponzi long forgotten, financially strapped nonprofits were eager to place their money with John Bennett and New Era. More organizations applied to his foundation, adding more and more generations to Bennett's financial pyramid.
When people get into the scheme, bright, educated, experienced people lose their minds. They lose their ability to critically reason, and they invest in these things.
One of the late arrivals was Dr. David Maines, director of the nonprofit Chapel of the Air Ministries. With his organization going through extreme financial hardship, David Maines looked upon New Era as literally a godsend.
Anytime there's that kind of return on your money, there's suspicion. But there are people with great amounts of money. For our case, we thought we will put in $500,000 and we will get out $1 million, and that's a wonderful thing.
David Maines raised $500,000 from individuals who had been very generous to Chapel Ministries in the past. 5 months later, he received the shock of his life.
It was about a 30-day period before we were to get the first $500,000 out of the situation when we heard the news through the media that the thing had gone under.
New Era philanthropy was indeed too good to be true. There were no anonymous donors. It was all a classic pyramid scheme.
And it was like I had been just smacked on the head with a ball bat, literally, because I lost my equilibrium. I felt as though I was going to throw up. I just wanted to die.
Well, we're doing everything we possibly can, Malcolm, to resolve the issue and hope to have it done as quickly as possible. Thank you. God bless you, sir.
2 years after its inception, New Era was closed down by the Securities and Exchange Commission. Bennett immediately filed for bankruptcy, owing $551 million. The single largest creditor was the foundation run by Glenn Blossom for $27.5 million.
When I heard about New Era's demise, my first thought was, people just don't understand. Maybe something had happened with one of them where he had not given the money at the right time, and that all of this would fall into place. That was my first thought, which is denial.
John Bennett is probably the poster child for not only a very ingeniously put together Ponzi scheme, because there's no doubt he saw in the not-for-profit circle a kind of trust, a kind of free flowing of money that doesn't happen out in the real world. He saw that and he saw to exploit that, so he had a spark of genius for this.
I'm a vision person, a visionary not involved in the nuts and bolts of the organization. Management was never my talent. Administration was never my expertise.
No one in the New Era group had any idea of the pain they were bringing to people, and that pain went on for months and months and months.
For many, the most puzzling part of Bennett's scam is why he didn't close it down before he got caught.
He could have run off with millions upon millions of dollars. He had many opportunities to stay away, to take it for himself. He didn't do that.
Perhaps the achievement of Bennett's lifelong goal, acceptance among the rich and powerful, was too seductive to resist.
I think a superman would probably do do a quick con, grab the quick money, wire it to Switzerland, and move. And there probably are some people like that out there. You know, the really good ones we never hear about. You know, the ones we find are the ones who kind of screwed it up. They started to believe their own lies that they were running a legitimate operation. This may have been some degree true to John Bennett. Maybe he began to believe that he was actually going to make it.
Typically, all cons are self-destructive when viewed in the long term, but it's important to recognize that these men, typically as psychopaths, are prisoners of the present. They're locked into the excitement, the sensation-seeking, and the delight of putting something over on someone on the short term. They're not focused on the long-term consequences of what they do.
Fortunately for Bennett's victims, through a generous group effort, organizations who made money in the early stages of Bennett's scam came together and donated funds to return 90% of the money later groups had lost. As for John Bennett, in September of 1997, he was convicted of fraud and sentenced to 12 years in prison.
I have learned a great deal through all of this. I'm ashamed. I'm remorseful. And yet, I know God has forgiven me. And I pray that you can find it in your heart to forgive me as well. God bless you.
Buy a certified pre-owned Lexus with a 3-year, 100,000-mile warranty. You won't believe you actually own one. Surprisingly affordable, only at your Lexus dealer.
This is my invention. The silverware instrument.
C'est les lunettes éclairantes.
You could slide them, but they don't slide by themselves. It worked. It worked.
Headlight.
It could change somebody's life.
24-hour sundowns.
That is the greatest idea I've ever came up in my whole life.
Morning rush hour moves at a different pace for the co-op of growers who make Florida's natural premium orange juice. Because they own the land, the trees, and the company, they can take all the time they need. So, if the oranges haven't reached the perfect ripeness, they don't pick them. Some things in life are worth the wait, and around here, great orange juice is one of them. Florida's natural. Taste the difference.
Monday on Paramedics. Heavy traffic and high speed. A disastrous duo.
The hole in the windshield is where the head went into it.
A young man lies trapped beneath 3,000 pounds of steel. A motorcycle policeman hits pavement. A pregnant woman is rushed to the ER at 150 miles per hour.
We got it.
In the super fast world of chopper medics, every minute is critical.
That's us, folks.
They risk their lives to save yours. Paramedics, Monday at 8, only on TLC.
Stevie Wonder, epic close of a century. The brand new collection that pays tribute to one of the most influential American musicians of his generation. Stunning sound, all tracks digitally remastered from original sources, including Uptight, Master Blaster, Golden Lady, I Just Called to Say I Love You, and more. This deluxe 4-CD retrospective comes with a 96-page full-color booklet packed with essays and rare photos. Over 5 hours of music from one of the most prolific singer-songwriters of our time. Stevie Wonder, at the close of a century. To order the Stevie Wonder at the close of a century 4-CD set, use your credit card and call the number on your screen or send check or money order for $59.98 or two easy installments for $29.99 plus shipping and handling to the address shown. Rush delivery is available, so call now.
Penny Adams is a property manager and mom in Los Angeles. Up until recently, Penny ran a fortune-telling scam that she operated out of a small storefront. Penny learned her craft at a very young age from her relatives. But it is not black magic that she practices on her clients. As Penny openly admits, it is a total manipulative con.
I knew it was a scam. Even at 8 years old, I knew it was a scam. Because it's something that they teach you that this is the tricks, this is the trade. I was brought up to believe that this was all a gimmick. This is all a lie. This is how we make our living. What type of reading would you like today? A tarot card, a palm reading, or a crystal ball reading?
When Penny began each of her fortune-telling scams, she had the same goal in mind. She wanted to keep her customer coming back, slowly escalating the cost of each session while setting the client up for a big financial hit. Take, for example, the case of Angela, a woman who came to Penny's shop 3 years ago on a whim. Penny went to work, trolling for any signs of trouble in the woman's life.
Well, what I'm trying to accomplish is to see if this person really has a problem that I can convince them that I can help them. And my second step would be if this person has money.
Penny found the opening that she and all con artists ultimately look for. Vulnerability.
Are you afraid that your husband might have another woman? When somebody comes in and is really gullible and is telling you, you know, I need your help, I have this problem with my husband or with my boyfriend or with my job, then you know that that's a good candidate. They're really gullible. Once that person has gained confidence and trust in me, then yes, that's when you go in for the larger amount of money. You don't do it right at the beginning because you don't want to scare them off.
As the customer returned week after week, Penny's rituals became more elaborate and more expensive.
Now, in order to remove this bad luck and this evil influence, we need to burn candles, and they're $100 apiece. Now, are you willing to do this?
Yes, I am.
Well, I never buy the candles. I'm just saying that I buy the candles, but I never go out and buy it. It's just another way of making an extra buck.
Penny moved on to more exotic, profitable treatments. She asked the woman to bring with her objects commonly used in fortune-telling scams. A single uncooked egg, a man's white handkerchief, and $900 in cash. Penny convinced the woman that if she got rid of this tainted money permanently, her problems would all be solved.
Basically, I told her that she needed to put the money aside because this money had evil and this money had bad luck and people were wishing bad on her. We would need to bury the money with the egg because the money is the root of all evil. And that she would have to go with me to the cemeteries, but that would have to be done after midnight.
When the woman told Penny she could never sneak away from her husband in the middle of the night, Penny graciously offered to perform the burial for her, but she needed more money.
I told her that it was going to take $6,500, and that's basically how I did that, you know.
And she did it?
And she did it, yeah.
And what did you do with the money? Did you bury it?
No.
In the end, Penny received nearly $10,000 from Angela alone.
I always felt a guilt when I was taking the money from the people, but it was something that I was raised and taught that I didn't have any other choice, that I had to do that. So I just went along with the rules and regulations.
In over 15 years of swindling hundreds of thousands of dollars, Penny was never charged with a crime. Yet Penny turned her back on the only life she'd ever known when she realized her young daughter was destined for the same life of lies and deception.
I don't want the same lifestyle for my daughter. My main concern is I really want my daughter to realize and understand that there's a different world out there for her.
Penny hopes her public confession will help all of us, especially her young daughter, escape the world of the swindle.
I want to basically let people out there know, don't be that gullible. Don't let other people take you in for your money. Don't see psychics. Be wise. Be smart.
Anybody can fall victim to a scam, and it's just a matter of finding the right one for you. You may see a scam coming and see and laugh and walk away from it, but the next person won't, but then you'll walk right into something else that you'll completely fall for. It's just a matter of time before the right one will find you.
To me, this isn't a hobby.
or even a sport. It's an obsession. So if I can't get out to this exact spot at this exact time of year, I may as well be bowling.
Get out there, an expedition from your Ford Outfitter. Outfitting you with the most far-reaching sport utilities on Earth. Ford Outfitters, no boundaries.
Now celebrate the 60s with this incredible photo collection and music CD, free from Time Life. Here's how.
Larry King for Time Life.
Here's a photo of me with my gang, the Warriors, back in 1950. Photos like this always bring back memories of my years in Brooklyn, but let me tell you, this new book by Time Life, The 50s, really takes me home.
It's part of our American century, a decade-by-decade scrapbook of our lives. What we drove, how we looked, who made us laugh and captured our hearts. It's all we experienced together. It's just incredible. Whether you're 19 or 90, you're part of this story, and Time Life captured it all. Turning the pages, you'll experience what life was like and see how we came to be who we are today. Each decade is filled with treasures only Time Life could bring you.
Call now to order the 50s for just $9.99. Use your credit card and get the 60s free, plus a free CD of 33 greatest hits of the 60s. That's a $55 value for just $9.99.
If the 50s defined our innocence, the 60s saw us come of age. And it's all here, from the voices and the struggles to the movies and the music that started a revolution.
Call now to order the 50s for just $9.99. Use your credit card and get the 60s free, plus a free CD of 33 greatest hits of the 60s. And there's more. Call right now and get a free commemorative calendar. Then examine other decades.
Folks, our American century is a collection you'll treasure for years to come. I know I will. So call now.
Call 1-800-923-8844 to order Our American Century for $9.99 plus $3.99 shipping. Use your credit card and get the 60s free plus a free CD. Call right now and receive your free commemorative calendar or send check or money order to Our American Century, Department 5, Richmond, Virginia.
Paramedics, Monday at 8 on TLC. Monday on TLC, from the capture of dangerous fugitives.
That's the guy.
To the flights of Con Air. The U.S. Marshals arrest and bring to trial America's most notorious criminals.
The worst terrorist act on American soil.
Under arrest, brother.
TLC follows them to Los Angeles as they hunt down their suspects.
Let's go.
Hands on your head.
U.S. Marshals, hunters and protectors, and inside the L.A. office. Monday at 9 on TLC.
Tuesday on Trauma. Sometimes life's roadmap takes an unexpected turn.
They were in a van, and the van was crushed.
One couple, seriously injured in an accident, puts matters into another's hands.
Hope in Jehovah.
What happens when in a crisis?
She's a Jehovah's Witness.
Medicine and religion meet face-to-face inside the ER.
There are patients that we can't save.
An all-new episode of Trauma, Life in the ER, Tuesday at 8 on TLC.
In all of the con games we've explored so far, each con artist ultimately had one goal. Money. Here, however, is a con man who may be like no other. He's currently serving time in a Texas prison, but not because he took money or property. Frederick Bourdin had a much more fundamental human need.
The person who created me didn't give me love and sometimes give it to me, asking me to be an adult before being a child. That means that I'm like a drug addict, but my only drug is love and attention. I cannot live without it.
Frederick Bourdin was born in Paris in 1974. He was raised by his grandparents until the age of 12, when their constant battles with Frederick forced them to put him in a government-run shelter for teens. By the age of 16, Bourdin was exploiting the European shelter system. He moved from shelter to shelter, taking full advantage of their facilities and services. But there was a catch. Each new shelter required a new identity.
I was changing my identity and my age and my nationality and everything.
Why?
If you have that, if If you ask me that at 17, 18 years old, I would tell you, well, because I want a new shelter, because I want a new home. If you ask me that when I'm 20, I would tell you, oh, it was for getting love, it was for getting attention. And if you ask me that now, it's because I have to survive that way.
In 1997, Spanish authorities became suspicious that Bourdain was using a false identity to remain in their shelter. Now 23 years old, Bourdain knew that if his real identity was exposed, his whole way of life would be destroyed. In his desperate search for a new identity, Frederick began making calls to the United States. He contacted the Center for Missing and Exploited Children in Arlington, Virginia. Bourdain posed as a Spanish social worker trying to identify a young homeless American.
She said, okay, what will be the name of that person? And I said, well, we think it could be Barclay because of the basketball player. And I know it was a very American name.
Bourdain struck gold. The caseworker remembered a missing 16-year-old named Nicholas Barclay, who had disappeared from his San Antonio, Texas home 3 years earlier. Though police feared the worst, Barclay's family was desperately hoping that Nicholas was still alive. Within hours, Bourdain had received a file containing photos and detailed information about the missing boy.
Inside was a picture of color, between other things, of Nicholas when he disappeared and what he could look like now. And, well, I look and I think it's a cowboy. It's not looking like me, man. It's green eyes, blue eyes, you know. It's completely different.
Despite the fact that he bore little resemblance to the missing American, Bourdain reported his identity to the Spanish authorities as Nicholas Barclay of San Antonio, Texas. But then came a twist of fate Bourdain never expected. Spanish authorities called the Barclay family to report that their missing son had been found. The family was overjoyed.
The director of the shelter called me and she said, well, your sister is on the plane right now. She's flying over here. And then I said, oh, man.
Frederick Bourdain pressed his luck. Using the photos in Nicholas's file as a guide, he dyed his hair blonde, faked tattoos to match Nicholas's, and dressed himself in a coat, hat, gloves, and sunglasses to reveal as little of his true identity as possible. The day of reckoning came when Frederick found himself face to face with Nicholas Barclay's sister, Carrie.
Nikki, it's me, Nikki, it's me. Listen, Frederick, you're insane. Frederick, you're insane, you're gonna get in jail right now. And so she looked at me and she ran to me and I walked toward her and she hugged me saying, oh, I missed you, I recognize you, thank you to your nose. And saying, oh, it's true, you change a lot, but you look just like Uncle Pat. And she was so happy, she was crying, she was really believing it was me.
Carrie had come to Spain to bring her long-lost brother home. After so many years of institutional life, Frederick was tempted by the idea of a loving family. Against his own better judgment, Bourdain continued the hoax.
And I said, well, Fred, you got everything you need. You got the family, you got everything. And for a second I said, okay, maybe if I've been so lucky in the past, maybe I'm going to be very lucky in the future. So at a certain point, I didn't want it to leave. But there was that voice on my head saying, Frederick, you're going to go in jail. You're going to go in jail if you go in that plane. You've been lucky, now get the hell out of here, you know?
Bourdain knew his only hope of explaining the many discrepancies between himself and the real Nicholas Barclay was to concoct an outrageous story. Frederick says he convinced Carrie that after his kidnapping from Texas, he had been taken to France, where he was tortured and sexually abused for 3 years. He claimed harsh chemical testing had changed his eye color from blue to brown, and that the brutality he had endured had drastically changed his personality. Frederick claims Carrie was overwhelmed by the horrific tale and accepted Bourdain as her missing brother. She then took him home to San Antonio.
People lie every day. People lie every day to everybody. I just do it the same thing, but I do it in a better way. It's what I'm good at.
When Frederick got off the plane in Texas, he knew the entire Barclay family would be waiting. It would be the con of his life if Bourdain could convince them that he was Nicholas. The biggest challenge would be Nicholas's mother.
And I just took a glimpse at her eyes when they meet mine. Actually, under the sunglasses, but... it's hard for me to believe that she did believe. I would say no.
Why would a mother accept a stranger claiming to be her own son? In public statements, the family said that denouncing Bourdain as an imposter would have been too painful for them, and that they saw Frederick as the last glimmer of hope that Nicholas was still alive. But after 3 months, Bourdain's con began to fall apart. The FBI, aware of the case from the beginning, began to pressure Bourdain for proof of his identity.
The first time I met Nicholas Barclay, I thought that the meeting was a very strange meeting. This individual had a very strong French accent, which Nicholas did not. This individual appeared to be much older than a 16-year-old, which was Nicholas's age. And his allegations of the kidnapping, of the torture that had existed for 3.5 years to him and to other kidnapped children was just so bizarre that I thought that how much truth could be in this, his statement.
When the FBI demanded verification, Bourdain was forced by the family to go to Nicholas's pediatrician to give blood samples for DNA testing.
We walk in the front door, and as soon as the doctor looks at Frederick, Frederick turns around and he states, "I'm not going to stay here. Everyone's staring at me." So he left the doctor's office and he refused to go.
I wanted to play with them. I said I wanted to play with them. Oh, it was easy to do. It was easy. It was funny even. I loved it.
Finally, Special Agent Nancy Fisher received a court order securing Bourdain's blood samples and fingerprints. The FBI sent the findings to Interpol, who confirmed that the man the Barclay family had accepted as Nicholas for 5 months was actually Frederick Bourdain. He was arrested and taken into custody that same day. According to the FBI, Frederick Bourdain is the only imposter to actually con an entire family. Frederick Bourdain was sentenced to 49 months for forging Nicholas Barclay's passport. He'll be deported to France upon his release from prison. Driven by his need for love and attention, Bourdain, like many con artists, became trapped in his own web of lies and deception. In the end, the only person Frederick continues to con is himself.
I'm proud of what I am. Because I've been capable of living through hell. I've been in bad childhood. I've been suffering for all my life. I still suffer every day on my cell. But I'm still capable of explaining and understanding what I feel. I'm still capable of dreaming that one day I will have a family and I will be a good father. I still have dreams.
Looking into the mind of the con artist, we've seen people yearning for power, love, and money. Motivations with which we can all identify. The only difference between them and us is that they have chosen to reach their goals at any cost and leave morality far behind.
Every day, they immerse themselves in the dark side of human nature. Their business is catching killers. Peek inside the mind of criminal profilers next on TLC. And to catch what's happening online, go to TLC.com.